We can take co-limit over subspaces of an infinite dimensional vector space. So the left-hand side was then called just CD, topologically enriched subcategory. And the right-hand side, well, it is what it is. There's a name this often is given. Loops infinity minus one, MTOD. But it's just defined to be that thing. just a couple words about the definition or the notation. This sequence of pointed spaces, T, D, comma V, forms what's called a spectrum. And that's what this notation MTOD means. if you precompose with direct summing with R, that's the suspension of that spectrum. And then this operation taking V for loop space and take co-limit is called loops infinity. And this minus one is also known as suspension. Anyway, the object I want to investigate in this lecture is the morphism spaces of this category. So I mentioned lecture two, I think, that in this co-limit, these morphism spaces become something fairly geometric. They have a bunch of components, one for each diffeomorphism class of cobordism from there to there. And each component is a classifying space for the diffeomorphism group real boundary of that cobordism. So that's something you might be interested in, whether or not you're interested in cobordism categories of field theories. It's a classifying space for manifold bundles. The cohomology of it will be characteristic classes of manifold bundles, and so on. It means, so W has some boundary, and it's supposed to be the symbol for boundary. And it means diffeomorphisms that with pointwise fixed on the boundary. Slightly better to say near the boundary, but up to homotopy the same. So that's the object I'm interested in. And I want to read this weak equivalence as kind of calculating this side in terms of this side. So so a priori. Okay, so, but the morphism spaces, individual morphism spaces, maybe I'm even interested in path component of a morphism space. So each diff boundary of W is a path component of a particular morphism space. In CD. Extracting information about a path component in a morphism space is a slightly awkward thing to do from knowing something about the classifying space. So in general, if I have a topologically enriched category, the best you can say is that there is a map from Hom XY, that's a space, to the space of paths starting at x and ending at y. So x comma y are in the object space of C, which is n0 of C, which sits inside BC. Omega is like loop space, but it's instead of, well, paths starting at x and ending at y. This is again just by construction of BC. A morphism from x to y gives you, by definition, a one simplex. So, and this is a continuous map. okay, so that's kind of a universal thing we always have. If, so, this may or may not be an interesting map. The case where, okay, let's call it something. No, alpha. Maybe it's a weak equivalence. it's a kind of standard fact that this is a weak equivalence for all x and y, if and only if HC is a groupoid. so, if this topological groupoid has this property, then we can opt to homotopy reconstruct the morphism spaces from knowing the classifying space. If HC is not a groupoid, we shouldn't expect any particularly good relation. Okay, so otherwise it's kind of awkward to reconstruct anything about these spaces out of knowing the homotopy type of the classifying space. Nevertheless, we still have the map. So, for the cobordism category, d-dimensional cobordism category, if I pick two closed d minus one manifolds, inside this Hom space, I have a component that has the homotopy type of, I mean, classifying space for smooth bundles. And I have this map, an instance of this alpha. and this theorem, whose proof I haven't talked about, tells me the homotopy type of this classifying space. So this becomes the colimit. okay, either this is empty, maybe these are not bordered. Maybe I should say it that way. This is either empty if M0 are not bordered to M1, and otherwise is the loop space of what I wrote over there. So that's called omega infinity MTOD, which is the colimit omega V TD comma V. the reason this is an potentially interesting thing to do is that this right hand side is a priori a lot easier to understand. So this is kind of a, I'll take the point of view that this is understandable. For example, the rational cohomology, okay, might not be connected, but the rational cohomology of a component is, it's a polynomial ring. It's the free symmetric algebra on cohomology of BOD, I think. Something like that. And if we have cohomology classes here, as long as we have a map, we can at least pull them back. Yep. Yep.
Sorry, does that bracket mean that it's that second thing for any choice of M0?
Yes. The only so if you have a loop space, all the path components are homotopy equivalent. So that's probably a little bit surprising. So the only dependence, the homotopy type of this is either empty if you're taking path between two things that have no path between them. Otherwise, they're all homotopy equivalent, independent of M0 and M1. Yes. And therefore, this answer is independent of that. So I get cohomology classes. In cohomology of B diff boundary of W, just by pulling back. okay, maybe I should say this is for D even, and that's a similar answer if D is odd. and this means, yeah, free graded. Commutative algebra. okay, so there's no reason to expect this to be an equivalence. So this is, let's say, far from an equivalence. Far from weak equivalence, because the cobordism category is very far from being a groupoid. But you can still say it's still kind of a surprisingly good map. so that's what I want to talk about the rest of this lecture. not exactly if you take the full cobordism category, but there are some subcategories with some remarkable properties that in the notes I call C, D, K. And K here is a number. It's at least negative one. And okay, can be anything, but it's not interesting if it's bigger than D. It's the subcategory with the same object set. But fewer morphisms. So the morphisms from M0 to M1 are the morphisms in the morphisms here that satisfy that the inclusion of M1 into W is K connected. Including an outgoing boundary is a K connected map. So induced map on homotopy groups is surjective on pi K and bijective on pi less than K. okay, then you first check that it is a subcategory, that this is preserved under composition. Put that on the exercise sheets. so for k equals 1, for example, k equals 0, let's take that. And just so I can draw it, let's take d to be 2. So the cobordisms are surfaces. The objects are one manifolds, so some number of circles. k equals 0, saying that the inclusion of the outgoing boundary should be 0 connected. 0 connected means induced surjection on pi 0. Which, if you say it in words, is just saying that each path component of W should touch the outgoing boundary. So this kind of thing is not allowed. because this element represents something in pi 0 that does not come from pi 0 of M1. So you can have this, and you also cannot have this kind of thing. but that's what that condition says, sometimes called positive boundary subcategory. and if k is equal to 1, the inclusion should be a bijection on pi 0 and a surjection on pi 1, and so on. somehow, this is, well, maybe I think find it a little bit surprising how useful this subcategory is. it's very useful for this question to get information about morphism spaces. so it could be that the particular W you're interested in is has this property of being K-connected relative to the outgoing boundary. So then, then I could use this restricted Cobordism category. let me continue talking a little bit about this case, but I'll say things that kind of apply more generally. so that's kind of a remarkable property. or, well, there's something that's possible in this category that's not possible in the full Cobordism category. okay, so let's first say C to 0 of anything, comma. so I write S1 for some particular okay, there's sort of many things diffeomorphic to S1, but I pick one of them. so if the outgoing boundary is connected, pi 0 is a single element, and then this map being surjective is just saying that W should also be connected. Well, we have a good classification theorem for connected surfaces. so, say, okay, so M0 is a one manifold, so at some number of up to diffeomorphism, it's like some number of circles. So W, if it's connected, so you could take like a pair of pants with k many legs, and then you could connect some of that with g many copies of S1 cross S1. That's what classification of orientable surfaces tells you, that it has to be diffeomorphic to that if it's orientable, and otherwise it's this connect some g many copies of RP2. so that's how many components this space has, and then each component is a classifying space for bundles of this type. with fixing the boundary. Right. In the full cobordism category, this would be some like classification of surfaces, a really classification of connected surfaces. If you want to write a list of all surfaces, there's some combinatorics of how do you, what do the components look like. So this is one thing. Now, this space is a functor C21M0M1 is a functor. It's a space. It's also a functor of M1 in C21 and M0 in C2. Whoops. It's a contravariant functor of the first entry. I want to take a very particular colimit. As in M, in the outgoing boundary, which I take to be a circle, so pick a morphism whose diffeomorphism type is 0, 1. Crosses one, connect some RP2. Think of that as a morphism from this copy of S1 to itself. So choose choose an element in C20, S1 comma S1, diffeo to this thing, RP2 with two disks removed. So that's an endomorphism here. composing with that gives a map from this space to itself, just because it's a category. And then do that infinitely many times. I haven't told you why I'm doing all this, but let's just do it and see what happens. Composing with this thing always brings you from this kind of component into that kind of component. Well, would somebody mind closing the door? So gluing non-orientable to a connected orientable makes it non-orientable. So if I do that infinitely many times, I can just ignore these things. So let's take actually let's take homotopy colimit. So this maps orientable path components of C20M0 to a circle to an unorientable. Does that immediately, and on these components it increases G. Maps the component of the mapping space with G many copies of RP2 to the component where we have G plus one many copies of RP2. That's if I do it one time. If I take the direct limit, first of all, these just become irrelevant, and all of these start looking the same. I just get Z many copies of the same space. co-limit over gluing this thing infinitely many times. either take homotopy co-limit on the space level or take co-limit of homology. C2, 0, M0, S1. this is canonically the same as, okay, here I have this G here is then the natural numbers, but if you take co-limit over increasing it, it kind of becomes Z. We get Z many copies. And all these components become the same. They all become some sort of infinite genus surface. Yep, right. But you need the bound in order to have the map. Yeah. So this complicated space with, okay, it's not that complicated, but the set of path components is sort of two copies of the natural numbers. And each component looks different. It has to do with a either genus G surface or a kind of this sort of non-orientable surface. In the limit, instead, I get Z many path components, and all of them look the same. So by this, I just mean kind of, yeah, OK, co-limit.
Sorry.
Yep. So you can rewrite one torus connects some RP2 is diffeomorphic to three copies of RP2. Yeah. Yeah, that's why this direct system maps in each step, it maps this type of component into that type of component. And if you keep doing that, you can just skip them to begin with by how co-limits work. Well, okay. So, okay, I lost some information. I might have been interested in B-diff of this type of surface, and I have some infinite genus thing instead. But maybe sometimes it's good to lose some information if you can then say something more. So, okay, that's one thing. It's still a functor of M0. Like, if you have k many things, you can have you can glue some cobordism, orientable or not. Stick that to this thing. So M0 goes to this. It's a functor. that well, it does something. It likely kind of changes these Z components around, maybe, if what you're gluing has some genus or some Euler characteristic. might change the number of boundary components. So at this point, want to use a theorem of a consequence of a theorem of Nash-Levall. called homological stability. Non-orientable surfaces. that implies that this functor sends all morphisms to isomorphisms. This functor and any W in C to 0 to an isomorphism. If you take co-limit of this homology, I think should be surprising. By now there are many such theorems, but a priori this has sort of no right to be true. Nevertheless, that's true. So I guess you could phrase this as being an invertible field theory. You could call this maybe a representable field theory because it's Hom into an object. But I don't know that that point of view is helpful at this point. Anyway, this is true. And the Z is what's left over of the Euler characteristic of the morphisms. Yes, so I start out with something that has multiple components, and I connect some with RP2. That maps some components into some other components, but it does not glue all the components together.
Is there a way of saying what this means in terms of mapping class groups?
Not the Z, but it's another theorem, which I was secretly involved in saying this, that this is also but that's a kind of a two-dimensional coincidence. This is also B of the mapping class group of that surface. Yeah, so you could say that.
That's true. I was just wondering if this statement of the theorem had some purely group theoretic.
Yes. I mean, that's okay. Okay, maybe I'm not. Maybe I should have said several theorems. There's a theorem of Gramain that this is true, and Natalie's theorem is actually about group homology of mapping class groups. Yeah. So I guess that's why I said it's a consequence of what she actually proves. Yeah. Yeah, what she actually proves is about group homology of mapping class groups, and she also proves something in kind of finite Euler characteristic, that if you just connect some one copy of RP2, that's a homologized morphism in a range. But after gluing these infinitely many copies of RP2, her theorem implies that gluing anything else induces an isomorphism on homology.